In this video, we're going to continue our prep for our EPA exams. That's the Section 608 exam, but in this video, we're going to talk about Type 1. If you have not viewed the core prep video yet, you do want to go back and do that. Also, this video is based on the ESCO Institute Section 608 exam. Okay, other exams may have slightly different material, but with the same endpoint. Okay, this PowerPoint is intended to prepare technicians for the EPA Section 608 certification. It's meant to serve as a guide for reviewing material related to the Section 608 of the Clean Air Act Amendment. It's not intended as a formal refrigeration training course, and technicians preparing for this exam shall be familiar with the basic vapor compressor refrigeration cycle, common service equipment, and procedures. This PowerPoint was developed by ESCO Institute with the most current information available at the time of this edition. Should EPA regulation change after a technician becomes certified, it is the responsibility of the technician to comply with future changes. The EPA also reserves the right to modify the test questions and/or require new certification or recertification based on advancements in technology. The EPA, the ESCO Institute, will update this manual as necessary to reflect the current EPA regulations and testing requirements. Okay, once again, this PowerPoint is meant for Type 1. Remember, you must pass the core and then any additional types of certifications necessary for the equipment you're going to work on. If you pass the core, Type 1, Type 2, Type 3, you become certified as a universal tech. So Type 1 contents, it talks about equipment requirements, leak repair requirements, recovery techniques, safety, and shipping. The EPA definition of a small appliance includes products manufactured, charged, and hermetically sealed in a factory with 5 pounds of refrigerant or less. In order to work on this equipment, technicians must have a Type 1 or universal certification. The sale of ozone-depleting refrigerants such as CFCs, HCFCs, HFCs, and HFOs is restricted to certified technicians. Now, being a certified technician is not a licensing. Okay, it does not allow you to work in a state which requires licensing. You still have to go through the state licensing requirements. Recovery equipment includes gauges, recovery machines, cylinders, and Schrader core removers or access fittings. Recovery equipment must be certified by an EPA-approved testing laboratory, example UL or ETL. When using system-dependent recovery equipment, it must be able to recover 80% of the refrigerant in the small appliance when the appliance compressor does not operate, and it must be able to recover 90% of the refrigerant when the compressor in the appliance is functioning. Evacuating the appliance to 4 inches of mercury is low enough to satisfy these rules. That's a key number, 4 inches of mercury for passive requirement. All recovery equipment must be equipped with low loss fittings that can be manually closed or close automatically when the hoses are disconnected to minimize refrigerant loss. Hydrocarbon refrigerants, okay, isobutane R600A is an approved substitute refrigerant for new household refrigerators, freezers, and combination refrigeration freezers. None of the hydrocarbon refrigerants can be used for retrofitting small appliances. They can only be used in newly manufactured systems. This is because they are an explosion hazard. They will burn. EPA does not require leak test repair for small appliances, but leaks should repair whenever possible to conserve refrigerants. Make sure valve cores are tight and the caps are on the Schrader ports to prevent accidental depression and leaking from the valve cores. Before beginning a refrigerant recovery procedures, it's necessary to know the type of refrigerant that is in the system. After recovery, if contaminants are present in the oil, the system will have to be flushed with a cleaning solvent designed for the type of refrigerant in the system. To speed up the recovery process, tap into both the low and high sides of the system. A reclamation facility that receives a tank of mixed refrigerants may refuse to process the refrigerant and destroy it at the owner's expense. Do not mix refrigerants in a recovery tank. You must have a tank for each flavor or type of refrigerant that you recover and work on. Self-contained, otherwise known as active recovery equipment, has its own means of pumping and removing refrigerant from an appliance. It is capable of reaching the required recovery levels, whether or not the appliance compressor is operable. Self-contained recovery equipment pumps the refrigerant into a pressurized recovery tank. Before operating a self-contained recovery machine, make sure the tank inlet valve is open and the recovery tank does not contain excessive non-condensables, otherwise known as air. Obtain accurate pressure readings of the refrigerant inside the recovery cylinder is necessary to detect excessive non-condensables. We all know refrigerant has a pressure-temperature relationship. Take the temperature of the tank, take a pressure reading of the cylinder. It should match what you expect or come very close to it on your temperature pressure chart. If it doesn't, you might have non-condensables in the system, in the recovery cylinder. Air in the refrigeration system will cause higher discharge pressures in the system and recovery equipment. Follow the operating instructions supplied by the recovery equipment manufacturer regarding purging of non-condensables. All refrigerant recovery equipment should be checked for oil level and refrigerant leaks on a daily basis. You do not want to use a recovery cylinder that is leaking or recovery machine that's leaking. When using a recovery machine on a very low horsepower system, such as domestic refrigerators and freezers that contain few ounces of refrigerant, it is important to recover the refrigerant from the low and high sides to prevent oil migration. A system-dependent or passive recovery process for small appliances captures refrigerant in a non-pressurized container. This may be a special plastic bag container large enough to contain a few ounces of refrigerant. An external heat source, such as a defrost heater, may be used to vaporize liquid refrigerant in the appliance. A vacuum pump can be used to evacuate the recovery tank before starting the recovery process. A standard vacuum pump can only be used as a recovery device in combination with a non-pressurized container. The vacuum pump is only used to reduce the pressure of the recovery cylinder or container into a vacuum before the recovery process. You cannot use a vacuum pump to recover refrigerant. While a system-dependent recovery equipment, some special procedures may be necessary depending on the condition of the appliance. When using a system-dependent recovery process on an application with an operating compressor, run the compressor and recover from the high side of the system. Usually one access fitting on the high side will be sufficient to reach the required recovery rate, as the appliance compressor should be capable of pumping out the refrigerant to the high side. The discharge line can be forced closed to force the refrigerant into the container. If the appliance has a non-operating compressor, it may be necessary to access both the low and high sides of the system to remove 80% of the refrigerant. To achieve the required recovery efficiency, heating and tapping the compressor several times will help release the trapped refrigerant from the compressor oil. Because appliances with non-operating compressors cannot always achieve the desired evacuation levels utilizing the system-dependent recovery equipment, the EPA requires technicians to have at least one self-contained recovery device available at the shop to recover refrigerant from systems with non-operating compressors. Even though system-dependent devices may only be used on appliances containing 15 pounds of refrigerant or less, depending on the amount of refrigerant in this appliance with a non-operating compressor, it may be impossible to reach the required recovery level without an active recovery machine. Small appliances are equipped with straight piece of tubing called a process tube, onto which a piercing type access fitting can be installed. After installing an access fitting onto a sealed system, the fitting should be leak tested. Solderless piercing type valves can only be used on copper or aluminum tubing. Access fittings tend to leak over time. It should not be left on an appliance as a permanent service fixture. If after installing an access fitting you find that the recovery system pressure is 0 psi, do not begin the recovery process. If the system is at 0 psi, it means it's open to the atmosphere. Do not begin the recovery process. If a strong odor is detected during the recovery process, a compressor burnout has likely occurred. When recovering refrigerant from a system that has experienced a compressor burnout, watch for signs of contamination in the oil. After recovery, if nitrogen is used to flush the debris out of the system, the nitrogen can legally be vented. You do not need to recover nitrogen. Small appliances used in campers or other recreational vehicles may use refrigerants such as ammonia, hydrogen, or water, and therefore should not be recovered using current recovery equipment. When filling a graduated charging cylinder with a regulated refrigerant, the refrigerant vapor that is vented off the top of the cylinder must be recovered. You cannot vent vapor. Hydrocarbon refrigerants are not approved for retrofit into existing household appliance. The appliance must be designed for a hydrocarbon refrigerant, must be labeled as to the type of the refrigerant, and label must be placed on the outside of the appliance in view of the service location. An HC refrigerant is flammable hydrocarbon, something like butane, propane, isobutene. It's a flammable refrigerant. So type 1 EPA certification builds on the core. Okay, so just remember, everything in the core is fair game for type 1 testing.